and welcome to Mindscapes, our series of conversations with men and women whose ideas, vision and philosophy define our contemporary world. My guest today is a distinguished security analyst. In fact, his name is synonymous with the security discourse in India. He's had a distinguished career as a member of the Indian Administrative Service and with different institutions and academic processes, including tenures at the University of Cambridge and Nehru Fellowship, working on this vital area. I'm delighted to welcome Mr. K. Subramaniam. Mr. Subramaniam, you have, in a recent lecture, you recounted this exchange between General Karyappa and Mahatma Gandhi,
yes.
Which was illustrative in some ways of the manner in which we have looked at national security in India. What was that exchange?
Well, General Karyappa went to see Mahatma Gandhi because Mahatma Gandhi had earlier criticized him in his column in Harijan because General Karyappa made some pronouncements while he was in course in United Kingdom, which was political. So Gandhiji had said that soldiers should not interfere in politics. Karyappa went there mainly to sort of explain himself. But when he reached there after some conversation, Karyappa asked Gandhiji, please tell me, if I am to train the Indian Army, how do I do it if I emphasize all the time non-violence? After all, the Army is intended to fight to defend the country. This was in December 1947. So Gandhi said, yes, you have asked me this question. I have not yet got an answer. I am thinking over it, and when I get an answer, I will give it to you. The point here is that at that time, Gandhiji had not solved the problem of how to use nonviolence in defense. Gandhiji used nonviolence, people do not know in this country, in what is called satyagraha, which was use of nonviolence in an offensive form when you were trying to change the status quo against an adversary who was trying to preserve the status quo. The British were trying to preserve the Raj, and Gandhiji was on the offensive trying to change that. But Gandhiji never solved the problem of how to use that nonviolence in defense. He owned it up to Karyappa. And we must also realize that at that time, Gandhiji had strongly supported Indian Army being sent to Kashmir to fight. And in fact, the Brigadier L.P. Sen, who went to command the Indian Army, went to Gandhiji, took his blessings before he flew down to Srinagar to take command. Unfortunately, in this country, people have confused Gandhiji's preaching of non-violence to inaction in all security issues, and that is great Gandhian virtue.
Why do you think the Indian elites have this lackadaisical, almost indifferent attitude in some ways to issues of national security in a larger context where they, on the other hand, seem to frequently speak of nationhood and national chauvinism in so many other spheres?
Well, first of all, the Indian elite are still not community-oriented. They look after themselves in individual or in small groups. Secondly, the Indian elite do not think about the long-term future. They are mostly worried about their immediate interests and only tomorrow. That's about all. They are not thinking on about what is going to happen in the long-term future. That's why you build colonies without providing water supply or electric supply, and a court gives you an order that the Delhi should be cleaned of polluted industries, and you don't take any action for 4 years. So this idea of acting, or rather having a proactive attitude and taking action in time, is something which we don't seem to have as yet developed. One hopes we will.
You've also been critical of the fact that our elites and decision makers do not sufficiently learn from the lessons of history in terms of anticipating conflict and how to deal with it. And yes. You have mentioned a colleague of yours' comment of the Panipat syndrome. Mm. In what ways does this manifest itself?
Oh, very much so. If, for instance, not only it is in respect of defense, but you would find that post-1947, our government has not released a single document. Our government is not even interested in finding out what really happened. That is because both the politician and the decision maker is not interested in learning from the past, nor is he interested in about the future. He's just interested how to serve himself for the moment. Now, for instance, you take today a case in which one retired diplomat, the person retired as ambassador to France, our ambassador to France, has quoted from recently released British documents that the partition of India was not decided as a result of a deadlock between Muslim League and Congress, and that too by Mountbatten, but in fact the plan was formulated in February 1946 by Wavell and submitted for approval of the British cabinet of Attlee, and it was approved, and everything else that was done afterwards was according to that script. Even though this has been published a year and odd ago in Times of India and commented upon, you find no politician in this country, no historian in this country, no bureaucrat, foreign office secretary in this country has taken interest to go and say, what are in those documents? What do they say? I mean, look at the significance of that. It would completely blow up the entire case of Pakistan if you knew that the partition of India was brought about because of Cold War considerations and not because of the problems within the subcontinent. And that Jinnah played the role which the British assigned to him. But there is absolutely no interest.
You know, as you have said, that this is part of a larger, what shall we say, national Indian mentality.
Our culture.
Our culture.
Yes.
Do we just wait for these cultural processes to mature? You know, as the Battle of Panipat itself had proved that this is something that we haven't sort of gotten around to solving for centuries. So what are the kind of impulses, the processes that you think will bring about change?
Well, one hoped that when this National Security Council was set up, that it would generate the impulses to bring about that change. Unfortunately, the National Security Council has not met, and it seems to have been swallowed up by the same kind of culture. All that one can think of is there would always be some people. There are people who usually urge political reforms who are not politicians. And there are people who are urging various other kinds of managerial reforms who are not great entrepreneurs. And similarly, in this case also, it's those who are interested in the long-term future security of this country, we are going to go on agitating about.
I should really add that in the last decade or so, since your name has been very proactively associated with the discourse, that certainly the discourse on national security is much wider, has a much broader base, and at least in the press and in the process of discussion, that is visible. Even if that hasn't translated yet sufficiently into action. You have been critical, and you just mentioned, of the national, you know, the working of the National Security Council, and you criticize, you know, amongst other things, the frequency of its meeting, the manner of its leadership, the people who were holding dual posts, and what have you. When you make that kind of comment, what happens? Does the government respond? Does anyone respond? Or does it just sort of seem to go out into blankness?
No, nothing happens. That's for the same reason. The elite is indifferent. I mean, there was one question in Parliament on this, and even though it was a starred question, it did not come up for supplementary answers because it was so low down in the list. Of course, usually this is one of those things people arrange, mm-hmm. that difficult questions won't come up for supplementary answers. Mm-hmm. In the same day in the order paper, mm-hmm. you put down that question lower down. Mm-hmm. Therefore, as of now, nothing has happened. But then I take some solace that I've been agitating for India going nuclear for 33 years. Finally, it came about only 2 years ago. And similarly, I've been agitating for a National Security Council for 30 years. At least in name, they set up one 2 years ago. Therefore, one hopes that this will come about. I mean, one has to be optimistic. Yes, it is still a heart-rending process.
Did you feel that this aspect of nuclearization, that the government handled I wouldn't say just the public relations, but creating the national consensus, both amongst the political elite and the intellectual elite, well, and if not, what went wrong?
In some respects, they has handled it well. That is when it comes to international interaction. I think they have more or less been able to have the courage to stand up to the international pressure. Having stood up to that pressure, they have more or less brought around the rest of the world to accepting not so many words, but more or less tacitly accepting India as a nuclear weapon state. There, I would say, one must give credit to those who handled it. But when it comes to creating sufficient national consensus and sufficient awareness of the consequences of that, I'm afraid we haven't done very well. All that need to have been done was on the day they announced the tests. If the Prime Minister had called all his predecessors, given them a cup of tea and told them, gentlemen, you all contributed to this. I have been fortunate enough to be able to conduct the test, but over the years they were developed by you. And therefore, let me make this announcement to the country and the world in your presence. If you had only done that, there would have been tremendous consensus in this country. There would have not been so much of a controversy. Similarly, the government has not taken any steps to arrange for educating the parliamentarians, educating their own foreign service, or for that matter, even educating the armed forces. There are no institutionalized processes to do that. There is an institute of Foreign Service Institute. They have not arranged a course of lectures for the joint secretaries. There have not been a whole series of, they could easily have got all the parliamentarians together and saying, okay, gentlemen, we will arrange for 5 lectures or 6 lectures so that you benefit out of those lectures. Understand something about this. No?
Are you concerned that having exploded the nuclear device, in fact, you are concerned, you have articulated this, but let's say, what are the concerns that the systems and structures for them to be a truly effective deterrent have not really been put into place?
No, that I won't say. That I won't say. Because even earlier, as far back as 1990, when it was first developed by Mr. V.P. Singh, he did appoint a committee in which I was a member. At that time, we did write down the procedures and other things at that time. And I at least I hope, and not only I hope, I think I am reasonably confident that that would have been built upon. Therefore, I am not, particularly worried that such things are not in place. But what I am particularly worried about is that they are in place, should be communicated to the Indians for reassurance, and to the Pakistanis to create a sense of deterrence among them. That has not been done.
Is there a fear that a nuclear Pakistan, a failing state, might not be able to exercise the disciplines and the processes of mutual deterrence that are inherent in any nuclear policy. Is that a nightmare scenario?
Well, that nightmare scenario has been articulated in a recent novel by Humphrey Hawksley. It is there in some other scenarios drawn up by others. But the point is finally this. We are hoping that Pakistani leadership would be rational. Two, we are hoping that by continuous communications with them, as well as spelling out our policy, we should be able to induce additional rationality in them. If we are going to say that they are not going to be all that they will not be rational, then there is nothing that we can do about it, excepting make it clear, if ever they use their weapon, they will receive punitive punishment. Because it so happened that the Pakistanis developed and assembled the weapon earlier than we did. And therefore, if they are irrational people, they would anyway have used it. Therefore, to say that if we didn't do something, that they would be rational, that is not a reasonable argument. Mm-hmm. Therefore, Pakistan, having assembled the weapon in 1987, and according to their own writings, having tried to threaten India in 87 and 1990, anyway, they had arrived at that stage. Therefore, all that we can do is to keep up our efforts to keep them rational, and at the same time, be ready to punish them if they ever step beyond rationality.
To what degree do you go along with the defense minister's statement about the nuclear deterrence being aimed at China, or in response to a perceived threat from
nuclear
China?
Nuclear deterrence is aimed against China in a larger sense, not in military sense, not in tactical sense, because China armed Pakistan. Therefore, when you are preparing yourself against Pakistan, you are frustrating Chinese designs. And you are trying to tell the Chinese that game will not give them dividends. To that extent, it is aimed at China. But not in the sense we are worried about Chinese military nuclear threats in the near-term future, and therefore we have got to be ready for that. But in theory, of course, when you've got a nuclear neighbor, you should be always be prepared for his sometime or the other not behaving rationally.
You know, we have been talking about the elites not being sufficiently proactive. And as we record this, only recently we've had the Prime Minister making a ceasefire announcement in Kashmir, and the offer to more proactively engage on defining the line of control between India and China. Do you feel some stirrings of a greater activism on these issues?
Yes, there is. And one can say, strangely enough, in the last 2 years, in one direction there has been a great deal of proactive thinking. That is at international level. How to fit India into a new international security paradigm. There is a considerable amount of proactive thinking, and I must say India has succeeded in it, to which you should give credit to the leadership. And there I would say a considerable amount of credit should go to the present National Security Advisor, Brijesh Mishra. But it is at that level. But there are lots of things to be done below that level, and even perhaps to explain what has happened at the international level, how India's position in the international security paradigm has changed and changed for the better. That has got to be explained. That's not being done.
Do you see this change in terms of the sort of Samuel Huntington's view of the clash of civilizations and India as being sort of the swing state is veering towards an alliance with the United States? Do you see that in that sort of larger manner?
No, not in Samuel Huntington's sense. Mm-hmm. It's much more in the Kissingerian sense. Mm-hmm. Kissinger, in his book in 1991 or 92, Diplomacy, he talked about the global balance of And that was a balance of power in which he said there would be European Union, Russia, China, Japan. And at that time he wrote, perhaps India. Mm-hmm. This was, of course, when we were just starting our economic liberalization, and when we were not a nuclear weapon power. Now it looks as though they have dropped that perhaps. Mm-hmm. And now they think India is part of it. And of course, this balance of power of Kissinger is on what is called the 19th century European model, in which the British manipulated a European balance of power. There was a European balance of power of Russia, Germany, Habsburgs, and France. And the British, being outside Europe because of the English Channel, they tried to manipulate that. Similarly, now the American and Kissingerian model is for the United States, as they call it, sole indispensable state, will manipulate a Eurasian balance of power model, in which there will be European Union, Russia, China, Japan, and India. Now, the whole question is, in this Huntington thesis doesn't come in. Where the problem about Huntington's thesis is not that we subscribe to it, or at the broader level, the major states subscribe to it, but whether the jihadis subscribe to it. Unfortunately, it looks as though the most fanatical followers of Samuel Huntington are the jihadis in Pakistan, who think that they have a clash of civilization with others. And since they have taken that view, you have to be prepared for the consequences of what Huntington prognosticated, whether you subscribe to it or not, that is irrelevant. But unfortunately, if Huntington turns out to be correct, it will be because of the jihadis in Pakistan.
You know, when you mentioned the jihadis of Pakistan, you have also been sort of quite emphatic in pointing out, the perceptions of the generals in Pakistan about Hindu India, and the unlikelihood that they would be able to respond or be able to absorb a sustained onslaught from Pakistan, and that we would tend to lack the will to fight. What degree, then, even if we don't accept Huntington's larger perception of clash of civilizations and how it might unfold, but do you in fact see aspects of security, in at least in our region here, as a clash of civilizations in that sense, of cultures?
Well, in a sense, I told Samuel Huntington that he was not the originator of this thesis. The originator of this thesis was Muhammad Ali Jinnah. Muhammad Ali Jinnah's two-nation thesis is, in fact, a clash of civilization thesis. So, more or less, Professor Huntington said, yes, that is correct. And therefore, in that sense, the clash of civilizations thesis was born in this part of the world, and it was the Muslim League and Jinnah were the originators of that. And it is that which is being later on applied to a larger context, with the especially rise of the fundamentalist Islam after the 70s and 80s, that Huntington has now put in a larger picture. And therefore, in that sense, there is that in this country. But the fact remains that this country is the antithesis of the Huntington thesis. We have here more Muslim population than there is in Pakistan. Here we have Muslims, I would say, not as satisfactorily integrated as we would like it, but still increasingly getting integrated here. You know, the richest man in India is a self-made Muslim, Mr. Asim Premji. And I mean, whether it's arts or culture or Supreme Court or armed forces, you have them everywhere, as they should be. And therefore, to some extent, the Huntington thesis has got to be disproved by this country. But unfortunately, the Pakistanis seem to be aiming at trying to prove it.
The other thing that you have been pointing to is that issues of national security are not merely that of weapons and a defense policy and national security advisor. They are interwoven with the fabric of economic relations, access to oil, of so many complex issues. As a sort of, let's say, a epilogue, a concluding statement, what if you had, say, three decisions you could urge in the government with the reasonable assurance that they would be implemented, given the complex matrix that makes up national security? What are some of the key things that you would like to see happen?
Well, that I have already spelled out in the Karyapa Memorial Lecture. The first thing I would like to happen is that the National Security Council should be energized and should meet regularly, once a fortnight initially and once a week later. Secondly, the National Security Advisor, this is something which has been misrepresented in the press. I am not demanded that the post should be separated at present. I have only said if I accept that imperative for the present, but then he should create for himself a second office of National Security Advisor's office where papers would be generated for consideration by the National Security Council in the overall context of national security being defined comprehensively, not only defense, but everything else which you just now mentioned. So that kind of office is necessary for him to do that. And thirdly, of course, is the National Security Council should become an engine for stepping up the awareness of the public men in this country, political parties in this country, the bureaucrats in this country, the academia in this country, and the media in this country on the issues of national security in its comprehensive sense. Those are the three recommendations I would like to make if people would listen.
Thank you very much. Thank you.